Many of you will recognize that the format of the lecture this year has slightly changed. This is as a result of many of you making submissions to us and various recommendations, which essentially urged us to add on the normal lecture the panel discussion. And it was very clear in the submissions that have made to us, President Mbeki, that those panel discussions must include President Mbeki. Also, even if I speak out of 10 in what I'm going to say, for a number of years, the 6 years that the lecture has been ongoing, this year we've got the youngest lecturer to have graced this place. On the purpose of this year's topic and about the lecturer, I'm privileged to call upon our patron, President Mbeki, who I dare not introduce unless I was looking for salary increase at this stage, to come and introduce the subject matter of the 7th Thabo Mbeki Africa Day Lecture and our distinguished guest lecturer, Chief.
Thanks a lot, Max. Not to introduce the subject matter, Professor Makanya has done that, but to introduce Judge Bani Afaku, our lecturer this year. But before I do that, let me acknowledge two of my leaders. We have only got two leaders in the hall. That's the Chancellor of the University, Judge Mwepe, and Mrs. Mwepe. And I should have said three. And the chairperson of the board of the Thabo Mbeki Foundation, Sis Lope, Lope Bam. But to say thank you very much indeed to everybody for coming this evening. This is indeed Africa Day and Africa Month. Well, it's Africa Day 2 days late, but it was decided that we should do it on Friday because, as Max has just explained, because of pressure from various people, it was decided that we should have a panel discussion after the lecture. So we'll have a longer time here, and it was thought Friday would be better than Wednesday. Which is why we hold this Africa Day lecture today. But let me say thank you very much indeed to Judge Bani Afaku for agreeing to lecture to us today, as well as the two panelists who are sitting here, Lawrence Juma and Otilia Mungaudze. And I do hope indeed that we will have the kind of interaction that was suggested when people demanded that we should restore the practice of having a panel discussion after the lecture. Yesterday I asked Judge Bani what I should say about him when I introduce him. He said to me what not to say about him. So we haven't agreed on this matter. So I looked for the best tribute to Bani that I could find, which doesn't say the things that I would say, but is good and correct. Judge Bunny Afagu is a Ugandan lawyer and an expert, it says, on conflict and transition issues, with vast experience in the fields of transitional justice, human rights, and criminal justice, and has worked in Uganda, in Zimbabwe, in Sudan, and the United Kingdom. He's also a judge in the United Kingdom. And since its establishment in 2000, he has advised the Ugandan Amnesty Commission, which was established under that country's Amnesty Act, on the implementation of its mandate, including on questions of accountability and negotiations with armed groups, including the negotiations which took place in Juba, South Sudan, between the government of Sudan and the Lord's Resistance Army. Judge Afagu has keenly followed the interventions of the ICC, the International Criminal Court in Uganda, and indeed is one of the leading analysts of that ICC intervention in Uganda. And as I've indicated, between 2006 and 2008, he was the chief legal advisor in a pre-mediation process between the government of Uganda and the Lord's Resistance Army, which took place in Juba in South Sudan. And in that capacity, he was responsible for developing and drafting the agreements, including on accountability and reconciliation mechanisms. And these were the first efforts to engage with transitional justice and amnesty issues in a situation in which the ICC was already active. We worked together with Judge Afagu in 2009 when the African Union asked us to look at the situation in Darfur in Sudan and make a report to them as to what needed to be done about that. And indeed, Bunny led us in terms of drafting the justice recommendations in our report for that in 2009 for Darfur. And after that, he served indeed as our legal advisor in our panel that was dealing with Sudan and South Sudan before South Sudan seceded, a panel which was responsible, among others, for facilitating negotiations between Sudan and South Sudan on post-secession issues. And so he's been our legal advisor with regard to that, and a facilitator, and an important pillar in terms of what indeed has been agreed between Sudan and South Sudan in terms of the relations between those two countries. This is ongoing work, and Judge Bunny Afagu continues to do what is necessary in that regard. He's written extensively on these matters that relate to peace, justice, reconciliation. We take too much time to mention all of the things that he has written on the subject. He is a recognized international commentator on these issues that have got to do with international justice, with peace, with national reconciliation, and is a frequent speaker at international and academic conferences on conflict and transition issues, including quite recently the Art of Peacemaking, Lessons Learned from Peace Treaties. There is an ongoing conflict between Tanzania and Malawi. Not conflict, a dispute about what the boundary is between Malawi and Tanzania. This is because of Lake Malawi, what the Malawians call Lake Malawi, what the Tanzanians call Lake Nyasa, as to where the boundary is or should be. President Chissano is in terms of those negotiations, and then Judge Afagu is again serving as an advisor in that process. I'm sure you'll also know that There are important negotiations that have been going on in Cuba with regard to Colombia, between the government of Colombia and the Revolutionary Armed Forces of Colombia, the FARC. And Judge Barnier again has been asked to assist the people of Colombia in terms of finding a solution to that conflict. And let me just say again, lastly, that he serves, as I've said, on the, I hope I have said this, on the UN Mediation Support Unit standby team. This standby team was established in 2008 by the United Nations. It's a group of full-time mediation experts that can rapidly be deployed to provide technical assistance to the United Nations officials and others leading mediation and conflict prevention efforts. And the team members possess expertise in a wide range of issues that tend to arise in negotiations, including constitution making, gender issues, natural resources, power sharing, process design, and security arrangements. From all of this, you can see that Judge Barnier is a very busy man indeed, covering the specific issues in our continent and reaching out into the rest of the world to help us, all of us, to make a better world. We had indeed thought, as Professor Makanya has said, that we should discuss this matter of the International Criminal Court in the continent. Because as everybody knows, this has been a hot issue on our continent for some time. And indeed will remain a hot court topic, I think, for some time. It was discussed, for instance, at the last summit meeting of the African Union in the end of January, and is coming up again at the next summit meeting, Assembly of the African Union Heads of State and Government in June, July, as to what the continent should do about this. This is because, obviously, as everybody knows, as a continent, we're faced all the time with these two issues very important to the continent of justice and peace. And what do we do about these two things? Because the continent wants both. It wants peace and wants justice. And the balance between the two and what you do to achieve both is not necessarily an easy question. I'm sure the South Africans here will know what happened in this country when we're faced with the task to answer that question. And we decided, let's have a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And even to this day, the debate continues, was that a correct decision? Barney, come. Thanks.
I think I should say thank you very much to the drummers to begin with. And thank you very much, President Mbeki, for that very kind welcome and introduction. I was going to say that when I grow up, I want a standing ovation like President Mbeki. But President Mbeki has been a great support and inspiration in the time that I've been working with him since 2009. And I'm grateful to him and to the foundation for this invitation to come here and share on this topic. I traveled with my daughter Stephanie, who's here with us as well, and I'm glad she's here to hear the discussion about this subject and the future of our continent. Now we're going to be discussing, and I hope that it will not be for very long time, because I do look forward very much to the conversation and discussion that we'll have, the interactions after the main lecture, on this subject of the International Criminal Court in Africa and this continent's quest for justice, peace, and security. It's obvious, of course, that the lecture tonight is principally about Africa. And you might think that is obvious, but it's worth just underlining that. It bears repeating that we're here to reflect on the future of our continent, how we view ourselves, how we deal with the conflicts that have continued to plague us, how we protect and defend our values, the dignity of our people, and indeed, as has been said, how we shall rise and recover and prosper. The topic tonight tells us two things about the continent, that it is on a quest. It's essentially on a quest for two types of things, peace, and there's a reference here to security, but I think we can sum that up as peace, and it's also on a quest for justice. Now, the word quest suggests a certain restlessness, a certain yearning, a certain search to find these two things. And it seems to me that the first thing that preoccupies Africa is the stabilization of our continent, and that it is in that context that questions of justice, questions of violations arise. And it's incumbent upon us as a continent to find a way that we can advance these two important values, how we can advance peace and security, the stabilization of our continent, at the same time as we advance the dignity of our people and therefore their protection from harm through crimes, serious crimes, and violations of their rights. But we're not looking at these elements in isolation tonight. We're asking ourselves, what is the significance of the International Criminal Court in the quest for peace, in the quest for justice? I think we agree that these two quests are ongoing. The matter of the International Criminal Court is an additional element. With or without the International Criminal Court, we would be struggling with these issues of attaining peace and attaining justice. But let's go back and just recap on where our continent is. We're commemorating, for most African countries, about 50 years of independence. I come from Uganda. We received our independence in 1962. I was born shortly after that independence. And many countries have been coming to that milestone of 50 years, as has the African Union. But it's a diverse continent of different countries, a continent where we have thousands of languages spoken. The estimates are between 1,000 and 3,000, if you include the dialects. So a diversity of beautiful tongues and identities, from Egypt to South Africa, from Senegal to Somalia. Africans are a diverse people. We're a continent of many different nations. But it's also this diversity that has been a challenge for our nation building project, that has been a challenge for our efforts to stabilize within the borders that we inherited from colonial rule. So we've struggled, after shaking off the yoke of colonialism, we've struggled to build nations within what are often very artificial boundaries. Now, it's a particular pleasure to be here in South Africa because all Africans who were alive and politically aware at the time will tell you exactly where they were when South Africa received its independence, ushering in a new multiracial and democratic dispensation. And will all of us remember the images of South Africans queuing up many, many millions to vote for the first time in 1994. And we, all of us, the rest of Africa, affirmed South Africa is free at last. But as soon as we had celebrated South Africa's emergence, we were back to the grim reality of the tensions, of the challenge of peace on the continent. Because as you'll recall, it's just about the time that South Africa was attaining its full democracy, that in Rwanda, a terrible genocide was taking place. So there was joy and celebration on the one hand, but also weeping on the other, elsewhere on the continent. And it's not only Rwanda. And following that, we had conflicts across the continent, the conflict in Sudan, which eventually was resolved with the negotiation of a peace agreement. It was one of those difficult and protracted conflicts for many years. In West Africa, in Liberia, in Sierra Leone, and of course, in the middle of Central Africa, the conflict in the Democratic Republic of Congo. And these challenges of conflict led the African Union, having taken over from the Organization of African Unity, to begin to reflect hard on how Africans can strengthen our capacity to intervene, to support, to stabilize this diverse and beautiful continent of ours. And we shall come back specifically to how the African Union has approached this matter. Now, the issues and challenges that Africa faces are not in a vacuum. We are part of a global system, a world where we are not among the most powerful nations, a world where political and economic power is imbalanced, and often that balance is tilted against this continent. We're living in a world, particularly after the collapse of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War, which has been described as a unipolar world, where there's one dominant power. Now, without the restraints that we saw during the Cold War, the tendency has been for the dominant powers of the world to make their mark on all of the situations that are challenging for us here on the continent. So we know that in terms of political power, this imbalance is reflected in the way that the United Nations Security Council is organized, with five permanent countries, none of them African, and the way that this power is then exercised to intervene on our continent. And I'll come back to some of the interventions that are to do with the International Criminal Court. This imbalance you will also find in economic terms, that Africa's economic development has been hampered through all sorts of reasons, but including this issue of the flight or export of our resources through illicit means. More recently, you'll be following the leaks from Panama, and you'll know the staggering amounts of wealth that this continent is losing. So the context in which we talk about these questions of justice is a context of a diverse continent trying to work through the challenges of nation building, the context of a world where the power balance is tilted against Africa, and where in, by that I mean where we have to struggle to make our voices, our priorities heard. Now I want to come to the matter of the International Criminal Court. This court emerged in this context when, after the Cold War, when you had the collapse of the former Yugoslavia, you had the genocide in Rwanda, you had the conflict in Sierra Leone, and you'd had the situation in Cambodia, when the global community made interventions, justice interventions, and said that the crimes that are being committed in Yugoslavia should not go unpunished, and then set up a special tribunal to deal with that, an ad hoc tribunal is how that's referred to. And the same for Rwanda, the same for Sierra Leone. So it was felt that this ad hoc approach to addressing these questions of justice, these questions of dealing with the most serious crimes, should be better managed by having a permanent court that could respond whenever there was a need for justice in those situations, including situations of conflict and repression. So it was that in the summer of 1998, most of the nations of the world converged on Rome, the capital of Italy, to negotiate a statute for an international criminal court. They managed to agree on that statute. And these are some of the key pillars of that statute, and they're relevant for the discussion we're going to have on how this court has operated in Africa. The statute that was produced in 1998 reflected the principle that some crimes were now of concern not only to the societies where they were committed, but to the international community as a whole. So crimes against humanity, as suggested in the name, war crimes, certainly the crime of genocide. So the statute set up a court that would be able to deal with these crimes. It also adopted a particular principle, because as you can imagine, the idea that the right to try your own citizens would be handed over to an independent court and prosecutor is a difficult one for states, for all states. And as a consequence, in the statute, they made sure that there was a principle that this court would not act unless a state, which is a party to the statute, was unwilling or unable, genuinely, to exercise its criminal jurisdiction over those crimes. It's called the principle of complementarity, a rather long word, but it means that states have priority. So it has been called the court of last resort. It was not intended to be the court of first option. It was intended to intervene when there was a failure through inability or unwillingness. To ensure that it delivered justice without influence, it was decided that the prosecutor should be independent and shouldn't take decisions based on what states wanted specifically, but would initiate his own investigations, her own investigations, whenever a situation arose in a country that had signed up to the statute. But one of the provisions of the statute is also that the Security Council has the right to refer a case to this court regardless of whether the situation arose in a country that was a member of that court or not. So as you can see, the court now locks back into the international system with the Security Council that is not representative. In fact, the Security Council, where quite a few of its members, but three of the powerful members, are not signatories to the court, have not ratified the Rome Statute. So you have Russia, China and the United States themselves not being members of that court, but able to make referrals to that court when they deem that is appropriate. Now, as you'll recall, that this court started its work in 2002. It had to wait from 1998 because it needed to secure the relevant ratifications. To this day, 34 African countries have ratified the Rome Statute, South Africa apparently being the first one, and also being the first country to domesticate the statute of that court, as you've been hearing in the litigation in your national law. I don't know how much enthusiasm there remains for the project, but you were the first ones to go back then. Now, then the action began. You now had a prosecutor who started to make sure that he had something to do. And I'll pause here and tell you my first experience with the court. As President Mbeki introduced me, he said, I was from Uganda. In 1999, I went to northern Uganda where there had been a long conflict between the Lord's Resistance Army and the government of Uganda. We called it a proxy war between Uganda and Sudan because they disagreed about the situation in South Sudan. So they were, in the language, supporting each other's insurgents. I went there to carry out some research on a rather dry topic, and it was access to justice in conflict areas. So I was meant to look into whether courts were working, and if they were not working, what did people do to resolve disputes and to deal with crimes. The area was still in a state of war at the time, and most of the population had been settled, forcibly in some cases, in camps, internally displaced persons camps, essentially internal refugee settlements. If you went to those camps, they were some of the bleakest places where anybody could live. I remember going to one of the camps, which had about 30,000 people living in a very, very small area. They hadn't had a chance to build decent housing. They had little huts, what in southern Sudan and Sudan they call tukuls, thatched huts with mud and wattle bricks for walls. I spent the time asking them about law, asking them about courts. They were always very polite. They helped me a lot. After I finished with my questions, they invariably said, but we want to talk to you about something else. And what they wanted to talk about was the government of Uganda's resistance to the idea that members of the Lord's Resistance Army should be amnestied and returned to Uganda in order to resolve the conflict. It's the first place that I had a conversation about the tensions between peace and justice. It predated the ratification of the Rome Statute. So the idea that this is a new debate in Africa is simply not correct. It's an old debate, because the question of justice, the question of peace, has always been a priority in African context. It's been revealed more strongly in some countries than in others, but the idea that those who commit serious violations of the rights of African people should be made accountable has always been part of the way that we approach conflict. And coming from Uganda, I can say that is true for the dictatorship of Idi Amin, that is true for the mismanagement of the country that followed that era. I'll go back to this camp where I was having discussions about questions of justice. When I left the camp, that particular camp that day, I traveled back with a human rights, a very senior human rights lawyer. She's not a lawyer, she's a historian. She'd been on a commission of inquiry in Uganda into the violation of human rights. And she had come to this camp with a film crew to see what was going on and to record. As we were sharing our stories, she said to me, "Did you notice that there were no flowers in that camp?" I knew something was wrong with what I was seeing, but I hadn't made the link that there were no flowers. And the point she was making was that this community had completely lost hope. They couldn't even plant flowers. Now, I'm telling you this story in order to reflect on the impact of conflict on communities. Not only were there no flowers, but the death rate of children under five in that part of the country was the highest in the entire country. And so the members of that community in northern Uganda started to advocate with the government to say, please reach a peaceful settlement of this conflict, because the price that we're paying for your insistence on prosecutions is too high and should not be paid by us in this way. In fact, they started to say that the government's policy amounted to a genocide of their people, because it could not win the war, but it was insisting that there was no room for sorting out the conflict peacefully, and there was no room for making concessions on the question of accountability. Now, this dilemma, which was being played out writ large, came to haunt the International Criminal Court when the president of Uganda referred the situation in northern Uganda to the ICC. And I'll come to the criticisms that they faced in Uganda. But first, to go back to say, just to recap, the formation of the ICC, the ratification by 60 countries, and the establishment of new cases. Now, the supporters of the court will point out in Uganda and elsewhere that Africans are actually the biggest bloc under their own statute. That 34 of the signatories are African countries, and they signed up willingly. They also point out that most of the cases that came to Africa, that came to Uganda, were on the invitation of the governments of Uganda. They argue that the involvement of the court has given greater visibility to the continent, has shed a spotlight on conflict in a way that might not have been possible but for the intervention of the court, and that the prosecution of key leaders concentrates minds and is a deterrence to others who might be tempted to abuse their power. So, according to this view, in general, the existence of the court has forced the question of justice up the agenda when it otherwise might not have been a priority. But as we know, there's been resistance to the ICC. And part of the reason for this, as we know, is that until very recently, when the situation in Georgia was added to the list of matters to be investigated, all of the cases of the court were African. And most of those cases arose in situations of ongoing conflict. And the African Union's resistance to this was because these interventions complicated the search for political and just solutions to to these conflicts. It is worth noting, in fact, that the African Union did not make any policy statements until there was an indictment of a sitting head of state. Now, the reason for that was that by going for the leadership of a country in a situation of conflict, in a situation where there were efforts being made to resolve peacefully a long-standing conflict, the introduction of justice risked jeopardizing that search for peace and stability. It meant, in its judgment, the African Union that is, that some other types of indictments might not go to the heart of the risk to peace. But by indicting a head of state, this was deemed to be a particularly dangerous move, especially in that delicate situation that obtained in Sudan at the time. The critics of the court say that the case in Sudan and later in Libya were referrals by the Security Council. They were referrals of countries which had not themselves signed up to the jurisdiction of the court. There were referrals by a Security Council whose members themselves were not parties to the Rome Statute. And so the Security Council had acted politically, particularly in the case of Libya, where after it had determined that there should be an intervention, blessed the NATO intervention, the Security Council had then supported a justice intervention. Now, the second element of the criticism of the court is that the powerful country's influence, the decisions of the court, they don't do this directly, but it is said that the court will take into account the political needs of the countries. There is indeed a tension between the quest for peace and the quest for justice. And it's very important that we don't deny that there is such a tension. Because if we don't recognize that, then we will not be able to find the balance, and it's a delicate balance to be struck when we're seeking to serve our African peoples. Now, the work of the ICC has been controversial, and we're going to talk about that. But it was a court that was called for by the world, but it was called for with certain expectations. The expectation that it would not be a court that would cause disruption. It would be a court that would ensure accountability, but it would be sensitive to context. And I think I remember it was Kofi Annan, the Secretary General of the UN, who, when he was in South Africa and this question was discussed, he made the remark that the ICC couldn't possibly have interfered with the transition in South Africa because it wasn't designed to thwart the aspirations of the African people, that it was a court designed to make sure that the powerful do not abuse their office by committing crimes against their subjects. But when you come to some context like Uganda, where it isn't the powerful, it isn't the government that is committing these crimes, but it is insurgents. It's people who are in contestations, often with the state, but sometimes with each other. It means that we can contemplate other options, other ways of ensuring there's accountability, and particularly justice done as close as possible to the scene of the violations. Now, for me, one of the most significant doubters, or people who've been questioning some of the direction of international justice more recently, is a very senior judge, indeed a Supreme Court judge in her country, and also a prosecutor at the highest level, who also served as a human rights commissioner. And this is what she said. I'll give you her name at the end. She said, recent events, whether the Security Council referrals, the difficulty that the court faces in Africa, or its balancing act in the Colombia case, recent events appear to challenge the assumption underlying the international justice enterprise that holding military and political leaders accountable for war crimes would actually contribute to peace by deterring such conduct in the future and by encouraging national reconciliation. She's saying that the evidence is that international justice, and I'm not just talking about the ICC, does not necessarily deter, does not necessarily contribute to national reconciliation, does not always contribute to peace. If you look at the combination of international justice and international intervention in Libya, you will see that it's not in a better place today than it was before. And I'll digress, and President Mbeki will remember this. Before these events, there was a lot of effort to say, take a different approach to Libya. Don't rush into it. It's going to be very difficult. And these were people living on the borders of Libya saying, we know our neighborhood. This is going to end very badly. But sufficient notice wasn't taken of those concerns. And a lot of people are paying for that. It is important, therefore, and I should disclose this is Ms. Louise Abo, who was the prosecutor of the Yugoslavia court and also worked for the United Nations as a commissioner for human rights, and is now and has been with the International Crisis Group. So what are the alternatives? In a sense, we're not talking about alternatives. We are talking about a holistic approach to dealing with the problems of Africa. What people in northern Uganda were calling for was not that there should be no justice, but that it was better for justice to be done in Uganda, and it was better for justice to be done in a way that was true to the community that suffered the most. It was important for justice to be done in a way that enabled the peace process to go forward and the war to end. And as one of those who traveled to go and see Joseph Kony, to explain to him that the world had changed around him, there was an arrest warrant against him, but that I trusted that the Rome Statute and the court was a court of last resort, and is a court that would yield to the prerogative of the government of Uganda and would respect the choice to have justice and accountability within the country. He cited to me, and those of us who were around, the case of Charles Taylor. He cited Toma Lubanga and said the reason why these people were taken off to The Hague is because they were weak, and they were perceived to be weak. The ICC is coming after me because they perceive me to be weak. What assurance do I have that if I sign this peace agreement, as you're advising me, and come to Uganda, the same thing will not happen to me? We couldn't give him that assurance because it was not in our hands. It was in the hands of the judges. It was in the hands of the prosecutor of the court. So I have no doubt that the reason we were not able to complete that chapter of conflict in northern Uganda was this big intrusion, this cloud that was hanging over the talks. The question of African alternatives, and I'll move towards a conclusion with that. What is it that Africa brings to this discussion of justice, to this discussion of accountability and peace? First of all, in dealing with conflict, in seeking to address the matters of accountability, the context is very important. Almost all of our conflicts, I don't know of a conflict in Africa that is not political. That isn't a contestation to be recognized within your own country, that isn't about marginalization. Some of it is about resources, but essentially it's about which group controls resources. So essentially it's political. And the danger with international justice is that it depoliticizes this context. And it can often leave the impression that it's a bunch of criminals running around. So as difficult as the consequences of this conflict are, the manifestations of crimes are, we must start by seeking durable solutions for those conflicts. And it's important to do so with the full participation of the people who are affected by the conflict. Nowadays, the issue of victims is being put forward. When I was having my arguments with the court and with Mr. Ocampo about his investigations and the potential danger, he said, well, the Acholi victims may not want this, but their victims next door who speak a different language, they will want justice. So he went to those victims and they said, no. We want now to secure the end of the conflict, and then we will talk about matters of justice. I'm not saying that in every situation that is a sequence that is appropriate. In some situations, clearly, a powerful abuser using the state, there may be no reason to hold back because you're simply turning off the power of the state. But where you have a situation that's going on and on and on and war can't end the misery of the people, then we have to look at other alternatives. And I actually believe that the Rome Statute has the architecture to be more subtle than it has been in the years that it's been operational. It has the principles to yield to the prerogative of the state. It has the principles to refrain from action if it's not in the interests of justice. There's such a principle in the statute. But what has happened is that the jurisprudence privileges prosecution, privileges going ahead with cases. So it is our responsibility as Africans to provide the reasoning, to provide the principles which would guide the development of international criminal law, would guide the decisions of the court, so that they are nuanced, so that they are adaptable and can reflect the needs of all victims, not just the ones who suffered direct harm, but also the ones who didn't plant flowers, the ones who lost their children as they were waiting for war and the crimes to end. Those victims count as well. And often they're the majority of the victims. The other thing that we can bring to this whole discussion of international justice, and this goes beyond the ICC, is the African idea of reconciliation. It's become a controversial term, perhaps because it has been abused to mean sweeping the past behind us and not confronting it. But reconciliation, I mean, a clear-eyed view at why things happened, why violations happened, but being determined to go beyond the status of a victim, but to be citizens together. Citizens that have been rehabilitated after their experiences as perpetrators or as victims, so that you don't have a country of victims, but you have a country of citizens with different histories, but a common future. We need to reduce this into principles that are justiciable, that can be understood by lawyers and judges. How can a system of law reflect those restorative values and principles that we find in our African culture? In northern Uganda, the communities insisted upon this and say we have a justice system that doesn't dwell on the past, that brings some form of end to the past, a ritual end to the past, to say we accept that all of these things happened to us. There's no way of denying that. But we want to bring healing, we want to move on together. I think the best criminal justice systems should lead to this outcome of restoring what was broken by the crimes. Because if we adopt a system that is exclusively retributive, so that the chief aim of the criminal justice system is to punish, to throw away the key after locking somebody up, it will fail to make the contribution to building a better society. Think about this for a moment. We are facing the challenge of what is called violent extremism now, across the Sahel, from Boko Haram to Al-Shabaab, to, you know, Al-Qaeda of the Maghreb. We're not going to indict our way through this issue. We're going to have to understand better the context that produces this extremism. What is the variant? What is the abuse of faith that produces this? Who are the people who get radicalized? Are they going to feel daunted by an indictment when they're willing to blow themselves up? I suspect not. So we have to be humble about the limitations of criminal justice. And we have to insist that, and to keep looking for the alternatives that will help us globally through the international criminal justice system, but also within our own countries, to find ways of dealing with the past that consolidates the prospects of a future. Now, I really will come to an end now. So what should we do? How do we come to a happy balance where we have an international criminal court that is a court of last resort, that manages its cases in a fair manner, so you don't have people endlessly detained without release, something that couldn't happen in a domestic court, waiting for years for trials. We don't have discrepancies in sentencing and so forth. How can we contribute to criminal court, which is a court that will respect the rights of states, of societies, to organize their own accountability mechanisms and criminal justice. I think we should start with analysis. We can't purport tonight to have all of the answers. The African Union has started by calling for analysis, by calling for brainstorming, by calling for the development of policy. But those of us who are outside the African Union should contribute to that, including academia, so that our jurisprudence can be informed by legal scholarship. And we can't leave it to lawyers and judges alone, because these conflicts, these tensions, these situations that give rise to crimes are intensely political. And their solutions are not only legal. So do trust the judges, but trust them with the letter of the law. What are the principles that should inform their thinking? Because they need to be looking outside of the legal texts for these principles. And these principles should come from the analysis we undertake. The think tanks, African think tanks, should make this contribution in partnership with our ivory towers. We should also mobilize opinion in a manner that reflects our priorities as well, that says that absolutely we must have accountability, but absolutely the conflicts of this continent should come to an end so that we can build a more prosperous future. I understand from the facilitator that he read my last paragraph, which is the conclusion. But out of Africa, new and good things must come. And out of Africa should come a rethinking of international criminal law, moving it away from retribution, infusing it with more restorative elements. Out of Africa must come new ways of ending conflicts, new understandings of accountability, which means that we continue to work with abusers until they're changed and until they reinvest in society. Out of Africa must come the idea that victims become citizens, become leaders, and become equal partners in shaping their own future. And we must be determined to achieve this, whether in or out of membership of the International Criminal Court. We must be clear for ourselves what our societies need. Thank you very much.